Hello everybody, hope you're well, and once again welcome to Let's Talk More with Rumel Guzar. Today my guest is Sarah Harrison, very well-known personality from Leicestershire, traveled around the world. We're going to learn more how challenging was for her when lockdown be announced March 23rd, 2020 by the Prime Minister. Stay tuned, Let's Talk More with Rumel Guzar. Welcome, Sarah. Let's talk more. How are you doing?
I'm okay, actually. I'm really good. Thank you for asking. Yeah, really good.
Long time not seeing you for past 16-17 months.
It's been a very long and tough 18 months, but actually, you know, really rewarding in a really strange sort of way, you know, just doing everything that we possibly can to have supported the businesses, obviously, through a really, really tough time. And it's just so lovely to see the city centre, you know, springing back into its normal, vibrant, you know, lovely place to be.
First, we're going to talk about, we just need to know a bit more about, we're going to learn about Sarah Harrison. You're very well known, very influentially person in the city and the county. Everybody know you, the city centre director, but we need to know, Sarah Harrison, where you born, where you brought up, and where you spend most of your life, please.
Gosh, how long have you got? I was actually born in a little tiny village called Hemingford Abbots, which is near Cambridge. My father was in banking, so we moved around all over the place. I had numerous schools. So we sort of had about 8 houses by the time I actually left home. I very quickly got into a sort of PR business role. I was actually started off as a PA and then sort of just grew into it. It was one of those jobs that, I don't know, it just felt right, if you know what I mean. So I was working in London and then I got an opportunity to go to South Africa. So I went off to South Africa. And I would basically then got into shopping centre marketing, shopping centre malls. So I worked at a fantastic centre called Sandton City, which is the largest regional shopping centre in the Southern Hemisphere, with a hotel complex and office complex. And, you know, that's where I cut my teeth and got the sort of retail and the destination bug, you know, creating a sort of destination. And then I came back to the UK, and then I went back out to South Africa again because I got headhunted. When I came back to the UK, I came back to launch Lakeside Shopping Centre in Thurrock. And then I went back out to South Africa again. And then I decided at the grand age of 38 that everybody had got sort of like a piece of me. And I sort of felt that I hadn't done enough for me, Sarah Harrison. So I didn't get a degree when I was younger. Had a very bright brother who obviously went off to university, and I sort of just bounced along sort of under the radar. So I went to the United States and I went to university there, and I took a degree in a BA in marketing and communications and psychology. And then I got a scholarship to do my MBA, so I stayed for another year, did an MBA in marketing, and then came back to the UK. and that's when I started my own business, HMark, in London, which was a marketing consultancy, specialising in property. And then I got headhunted to Dubai, so I went off to Dubai for nearly four years, which was fantastic, and basically was involved, was marketing director for Dubai Festival City, which is on the creek. And then my parents were getting elderly and needed more help. So I decided to come home and this job came up and it had my name on it.
What's your favourite food?
Oh, now that's another one, isn't it? Actually, my favourite food, believe it or not, is a fry up, a typical English British fry up. And that is because that's what my dear darling dad used to love. And it's something that even as a child we used to share as a treat. But if I'm going out, I love Italian, I love curries, I love Thai. I like food that's got a lot of flavour to it, but I don't like bulk of food, if you know what I mean. So I like little bits that have got different flavours. So yeah, I'm very easy to please when it comes to food.
You're a traveller, travel kind of around the world, all some of the country very strongly, sunshine. What's your favourite holiday destination where you want to just be relaxed?
I love Spain. I've actually got an apartment in Spain, but I haven't been there for ages, but because of, you know, looking after my parents. But I just love the Spanish. I love the heat. as I said, I've got lots of favourite places. I mean, I'm very lucky. I've travelled extensively. So it sort of really depends whether you want a relaxing holiday or whether you want an educational holiday. Or, you know, I love history and different cultures. So I've been lucky. I've been to India. You know, I've been to all around South America. I love learning about different cultures and how people live their lives, you know, differently to a Western world. So it really depends. But for me, a beach, you know, Mauritius, Barbados, anywhere like that is my luxury. But I'm very happy to go to Spain and I'm very happy to go to Cornwall. So, you know.
So everybody, childhood, have a dream. When they grow, when they graduate, we want to be a doctor, we want a lawyer, or any other profession. What your dream was?
I desperately wanted to be a vet on a game reserve in Africa, specialising in big cat. That was what my dream was. And actually, it's interesting how dreams can be crushed so quickly, because my mother took me down to the local vet. And he just basically said, oh, you're a female, you know, you need strength if you want to do that sort of thing. You'll just get stuck with cats and rabbits and bunny rabbits and, you know, some guinea pigs. So, you know, you'll never realise your dream. So I basically was sort of frog marched out of there and say, well, there you go, never mind. I think secretly my parents probably were dreading the fact it was 8 years of veterinary college. But yeah, but that was my dream. And I'm still a great, great animal lover. So that never went away. Yeah.
And we're just talking about you have a pleasure to be in the same room where Nelson Mandela was. Can you share that moment, please?
Yeah, it was amazing. It was obviously when I was in South Africa, it was the change of when just before the elections when Nelson Mandela was going to get into power. He came to the complex, to the hotel, to give a speech. And, you know, people say about charisma, I can honestly say I've never been in a room where you couldn't hear a pin drop, because just the very presence of the man, and I don't say that lightly, it was really inspiring. And for somebody not to bear any malice against the people that had acted so, you know, cruelly against him when he was locked up in Robben Island, etc., you know, and just to actually look at the positivity in the future and wanting the country and his people to do well. I mean, it was something I'll never, ever forget, ever. And that gorgeous smile that he has, that enigmatic smile that he has, yeah.
Sarah, past 17, 16 months, very tough for all of us, and everybody have some low time, some high time. How much impact have in your personal life?
Well, it's been quite difficult for me because I lost my mum during COVID. It wasn't because of COVID, but obviously she was in an old people's home, so I wasn't allowed to see her for 8 months, which was really tough because I used to see her every night on my way home from work and at the weekends. She found it very tough. She couldn't work out because she had dementia as to why her family had abandoned her, which was really hurtful. But luckily at the end, you know, she was a great age. She was, you know, well in her 90s, so she had a fantastic life, and it was a peaceful passing. But I have lost altogether 7 people over the last 18 months to COVID, so it has been tough. As I mentioned before, I do live on my own, and obviously working from home, so there's a lot of time when you're just on your own. Luckily, you know, I am resilient, and I've sort of managed it through keeping in contact with family and good friends. I've got a friend who's a neighbour, and we just made sure that we walked whatever the weather was, that we just went out, you know, and I think that was really sort of healthy. Work-wise, it was so busy and actually quite challenging because I was doing my day job plus everything to do with COVID. So in a strange way, it was a great challenge, and I felt I was learning. You know, and I just really do love to always sort of progress and develop. And I think one of my most rewarding things was when it came to the grant funding that the government were giving. I was worked very closely with our finance team and Revs and Bens, who did the most amazing job. I mean, paying out over £120 million to over 7,000 businesses. But to be able to identify some of the businesses that might have slipped through the net because of the criteria, and actually to know that you had a part in saving people's businesses, you know, was really rewarding, because, you know, they're great businesses and you want people to succeed. So yeah, it's been tough. It doesn't seem like 18 months. It seems like another lifetime ago, doesn't it? You know, sort of really, really strange. But Yeah, I think a lot of personal lessons learned as well. You know, I got to know myself even more than I do already. You certainly know, you know, your who you can depend on, who's really rooting for you, you know. So it was a strange but interesting time.
Your day role is City Director, City Centre Director for Leicester City Council. Can you describe that, please?
Yeah, well, I mean, basically, in simple terms, I'm like the link between the city centre businesses, predominantly in the retail, food and beverage and hospitality sectors, because we have a separate team for inward investment. So I'm the link between them and the council. So, you know, obviously my job is to try and, you know, do everything we possibly can to get city centre to perform to its best ability and to help those businesses and to make it an enjoyable experience for residents. So generally, you know, I've liaised on a daily basis with people. I'm also a member of the Business Improvement District. I'm on their board, so I work very closely with the BID. The advantage of that is that the BID obviously has funding and has money to be able to spend to realise a lot of what I had wanted to do in the past but never had money to do. So that's been really rewarding. And I also lead on tourism for the city. So, you know, getting that visitor economy, you know, because we've got such a fantastic offer, we just need to shout more about it.
During this lockdown and COVID-19, a lot of small businesses, especially in the city centre, has despair. And they have faced a lot of challenge. And have you noticed since reopening and after all this government funding, Leicester City Council, you're part of that, provided that funding, do you think they will be bounced back?
Well, actually, I'm going to have to take you to task on that because there have been over 40 new businesses that have either opened or are about to open in the city centre. So what we're actually seeing is that many businesses have had, they said that actually they had the time to take a step backwards to look at their businesses, and they've introduced different business models which have given them different income streams, like takeaways when, you know, people weren't doing takeaways. And I think a lot of people that have had a dream about having their own business has just, you know, COVID has made them think you really need to just, you know, go for your dream. And so there's a lot of independent businesses that have opened in the city centre. And it's, I mean, I was talking to an agent the other day and he said, honestly, our problem is that we're running out of space.
When the government announced, especially with hospitality business in Leicester City Centre, all the restaurants and to seating out, and I believe and your team did very well to support the providing them funding to be to business keep going. You think that momentum will be carry on for outside culture eating?
Well, I hope so, because I mean that's what has been a big success. We were very quick out of the blocks, you know, compared to a lot of other locations when it came to giving grants for cafe seating, and we also paid for the license for the outdoor seating as well. So lots of businesses that hadn't had outdoor seating before, you know, were now able to take advantage of that. And I think it's been so successful for them that they will continue to do that. I mean, we've given out over £250,000 worth of grants, which has created over 1,500 more seats outside on the public realm. And of course, as the public realm, it continues to be, you know, made more attractive. I mean, it's just lovely to hear that laughter and hear that, you know, the voices as you walk through the streets now of all the different languages being spoken as well. So I think it's here to stay, definitely.
City Council and your team pay a lot of attention to the hospitality business. Do you think equal support to have other small business in the city centre?
But the government gave destinations some European funding for supporting the reopening of the high streets and also some welcome back funding, which goes on till March 2022. And they're really clear that that funding is to support all the different business sectors. So we've supported, you know, they've travel, retail, sports, theatre, in particular culture, you know. So we've got a, you know, great theatre campaign and cinema campaign coming up to get people, you know, to give them the confidence to come back and support, you know, our wonderful culture that we have throughout the city.
Last thing, what's your final message to all those businesses? They have a fear, they maybe they're thinking losing the jobs, losing the businesses. What message for them? How you can build their confidence to keep going?
Well, I think they need to look back at what they've done and achieved over the last 18 months. I mean, full of awe and their resilience, their positivity. You know, they really have dug in and kept going. I mean, I've had very little negativity from the businesses myself. You know, they're looking for ways that they can, you know, not only continue but also improve what they do in the future. So I think the future's bright. I really do. I mean, and, you know, if you've got a good business model and you've got good staff and you've got a good offer in the first place, you're going to succeed.
How are you going to describe Sarah Harrison?
Oh, my goodness. That's a good one, isn't it? How do I describe? I think I'm very positive, passionate, energetic person. I am resilient. I'm a very loyal friend as well. But I do have the other side of me that don't cross me. I hate injustice, absolutely hate injustice. But I think, you know, I just try and be a decent human being. I really do. I mean, I always, you know, I love life and I love people. So, yeah, I'm a happy person.
Are you happy to see City back in life?
Oh, my goodness, yes. I mean, it was so sad when it was, I mean, it was clean. It was desperately clean when nobody was there. But it's just not right, is it? You can't have a city centre that's not got that vibrancy and, you know, people. It's a meeting place, isn't it? A city centre, an absolute meeting place. So, and for, you know, somewhere like Leicester City Centre, it's for multi-experiences. I mean, you may come in to go to the doctor, but you'll meet a friend for coffee or you'll have lunch or you'll go to the theatre later in the evening. So, yeah, no, it's just wonderful to see it all being used again, how it should be.
If that lockdown happened again, are we prepared?
Oh, my goodness, yes. I mean, I have to, I mean, I know it's, I sound, because I obviously work for the council, but honestly, I have been so impressed by the council and all, you know, the whole machine of the council, the quickness to response, their leadership, you know, and all the different services, you know, from whether it's transport or public health or anything. And, you know, lots of staff got redeployed to do other functions and they just, you know, volunteered, they responded so quickly. So, my goodness, yeah, if anybody's prepared, God forbid, but anybody's prepared that we ever had to face another pandemic, then Leicester City Council and the city is well prepared, yeah.
What's your final word to our viewers?
Well, final word to the viewers is just thank you to everybody for the part that they played over the last 18 months and just, you know, support your city. As I said before, please, please support the businesses. They have been through an incredibly difficult time and, you know, we want to maintain, you know, that sort of diversity of offer. We've got so many fantastic independents, but they need your money, so think twice, and before you buy anywhere else, please just stay loyal to lovely Leicester.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for watching this episode and listening. Sarah Harrison, Director of Leicester City Centre, a lot of responsibility. As she said, we're very pleased to support all these businesses, and her message, and for my personal message, stay local, support local. I will be back next week with a new guest. Stay tuned. Let's talk more with Ramil Gulzar.